think, is bound to become one of the most egregious cases in the harassment and abuse of a black elected official in the history of the United States Justice Department.
And they come in with a bankruptcy claim, a false bankruptcy claim against nonprofit publishing houses and shut them down. What's the First Amendment worth, you know?
You don't get any respect, even if you try to work with them. They manipulate and use you, and when they're finished, they cast you away.
At this particular case, the Justice Department is much worse of a villain than the KGB.
And what Theo said earlier about, I love my country, but I'm afraid of my government. Something's very wrong here, people.
On November 17, 1993, the U.S. Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled that the U.S. Department of Justice had committed fraud upon the court by falsely and maliciously prosecuting retired auto worker John Demjanjuk, a court decision which finally closed a 17-year ordeal which almost resulted in Demjanjuk's execution. Even more shocking, the same corrupt members of the Justice Department's permanent bureaucracy have been found to be at the center of many other cases in which there is indisputable proof of gross prosecutorial misconduct. On August 31st and September 1st, 1995, a distinguished panel of American legislators and international observers held extraordinary hearings to investigate the Justice Department's politically motivated and illegal targeting of groups and individuals. The panel included Representative William Clark of Alabama, Representative Toby Fitch of North Carolina, Senator Robert Ford of South Carolina, Senator Maggie Wallace Glover of South Carolina, Monsignor Elias El Hayek of Montreal, Representative John Hilliard of Alabama, Representative Howard Hunter of North Carolina, Representative Ulysses Jones, Jr. of Tennessee, and Representative Percy Watson of Mississippi. The hearings were observed by Dr. Kofi Awoonor, former ambassador to the United Nations of the Republic of Ghana, Marino Elseviff of the Dominican Republic, Dr. Josef Miklosko, former vice premier of the Republic of Czechoslovakia, and noted civil rights leader Amelia Boynton Robinson. The first day's sessions were largely devoted to one of the ugliest stories in U.S. judicial history, the campaign to harass, entrap, and prosecute every African-American elected official in America. This was followed by the case of Lyndon LaRouche, often referred to as the American Dreyfus, which included testimony from attorney Odin Anderson, LaRouche himself, and former U.S. Attorney General Ramsey Clark. The Demjanjuk case was detailed by his Israeli attorney, Yoram Sheftel, who risked his own life to save his client from the hangman. And Dr. Hans Kuchler, president of the International Progress Organization, described how former UN General Secretary Kurt Waldheim, when he became president of Austria, also became a target of a corrupt unit within the U.S. Department of Justice. The hearings were chaired by former South Carolina Congressman James Mann and by Alabama's most renowned civil rights attorney, J.L. Chestnut.
This is an independent panel of my distinguished colleagues from all over this country who have come to this place at this time to investigate allegations of misconduct by the United States Department of Justice generally, and in particular their targeting of black elected officials.
But I've heard some things here in the past 2 days that really bother me tremendously about the United States Justice Department. We have heard tales of actually, I think, criminal and deliberate suppression of evidence by certain sections, what is that, OSI? In the Justice Department, and also what you call prosecutorial abuse by that particular section in the Justice Department and the Justice Department as a whole. And it really bothers me, and I'd like to know just what we can do specifically to ensure that this doesn't happen in the future.
Well, I think your interpretation of what you heard is right. Let me just talk about the Demjanjuk case for a moment, which I've followed from its inception.
That's one of the
things
that particularly bothers me.
Yeah, they got away with it all the way up to the United States Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit. COSI is such a special office. It arose from hatred. It was, a generation after World War II, when you've got septuagenarians and octogenarians, and if there's ever any chance or hope in life for reconciliation, the moral of OSI is this. If you can find a Nazi who's 95 years old and on his deathbed and death rattling, you can get to him and strangle him before he dies, do it. It really is. I've watched them strike fear in whole communities in Toronto, Canada, and Southern California of Lithuanians and people from all over East Europe because the elders are about to be grabbed, to appease hatred. Statute of limitations are special things, but there comes a time when you ought to believe that reconciliation is possible. You don't have to, you never forget, because the long struggle for freedom is between memory and forgetting. You don't forget, but you do reconcile. You do recognize our common humanity, and you try to pull people back together.
The Demjanjuk affair started as a Soviet plot in the very beginning of 1976 through a Soviet crony named Michael Hanushak, which is an editor, used to be an editor, of a Ukrainian communist newspaper published in New York under the name of the Ukrainian Daily News. The affair started by an attempt to implicate Demjanjuk for being a guard in the notorious death camp of Sobibor. Sobibor, it's worthwhile to mention, is a death camp which between spring of 1942 to the autumn of 1943, 600,000 Jews were slaughtered there in front of the Allies, which knew exactly what's happened there and didn't lift a finger to save even one Jewish child from the Holocaust, which took place in Sobibor. And the allegations were that Demjanjuk was a guard in that death camp. This is the Soviet plot in the Demjanjuk affair. Few months later, in the state of Israel, as a result of an extremely suggestive photo spread, this one, the two bottom pictures are the target pictures. From the left is the picture of Demjanjuk from 1951, and from the right is a picture of Fedorenko, which was alleged and admitted to be a guard in the Treblinka death camp. Because of this photo spread that was shown in Israel to Holocaust survivors, mainly from Sobibor and Treblinka, Demjanjuk was wrongly identified as Ivan the Terrible from the death camp of Treblinka, a death camp that between the 27th of July, 1942, to the 2nd of August, 1943, 870,000 Jews were slaughtered there. Now, 10 years later, this mistaken identity case deteriorated in the state of Israel to one of the worst show trials of the century, where Demjanjuk was tried in a theater hall in the one and only ever televised case in the history of the land, and the television was invited by the court and the prosecution. And in the end of these proceedings, as everyone could anticipate when they started, Demjanjuk was sentenced to death in 25th of April, 1988. However, on the way of the Demjanjuk affair from being a case of mistaken identity to a vicious show trial, it became one of the worst cases of cover-up in modern history. And this is due to the enormous, unprecedented misconduct of the Department of Justice, more specifically, the Office of Special Investigation, which is a body within the Justice Department. I will focus in my presentation in that part of the Demjanjuk affair only, because I think this is what is in the interest of this panel to find out. The lawsuit against Demjanjuk to revoke his American citizenship was produced to the Cleveland Federal Court in September 1977. Although the sole proof against Demjanjuk were identification from this extremely suggestive photo spread, still there can be no doubt that the Justice Department did believe genuinely in September 1977 that Demjanjuk is that monster from Treblinka known as Ivan the Terrible by the unfortunate Jews that worked as slaves in that camp. But less than a year after this indictment of Demjanjuk was presented to the federal court in Cleveland, the OSI received through the American Embassy in Moscow material, to be precise, at the 12th of August 1978. And this material was a telegram with 100 pages of documents which were requested by the OSI in connection with another case altogether, to the case of John Demjanjuk, a case which the OSI conducted and lost in the matter of Fyodor Fedorenko. However, with that material didn't focus only on Fedorenko, but it gave broad evidence about the criminal activities of other guards in Treblinka, most of them, not all of them, from Ukrainian origin, which were Soviet soldiers that fell to German captivity and volunteered to assist the SS in the process of exterminating the Jews in the death camps. And that information that the OSI received also contained information about the real identity of Ivan the Terrible. There were four Treblinka guards. The names of them is Ivan Shevchenko, Pavel Leleko, Alexander Yeager, and Sergei Vasilyenko, which all stated, and we're talking about 1944, 1945, 1947, with no relationship 40 years prior to the case of John Demjanjuk, that the man known in Treblinka as Ivan the Terrible, the one that operated the gas chambers in Treblinka that gassed 870,000 Jews, was Ivan Marchenko. Now, I want to read to you shortly and briefly the statement, a small part of the statement of Vasilienko, in order to demonstrate how clear the evidence already in August 1978 is within the hands of the OSI that Demjanjuk cannot be, under any circumstances, Ivan the Terrible. Marchenko Ivan, the operator of the motor of the gas chambers in Treblinka camp. The Jews in the work crews called him Ivan the Terrible. He was noted for his great cruelty to the people during the process of their extermination. He beat them with obvious enjoyment and whatever came to his hand, however he wanted. And then Vasilienko was also presented with this picture of two Treblinka guards and was asked to tell who these two guards are. And looking at this picture, which is part of that statement which was in the OSI hands as early as August 1978, that's what Vasilienko said. The picture shows guards of the SS forces in the Treblinka camp. Takchuk is the one holding a pistol in his hand, and he referred to this one, which holding a pistol in his hand. Next to him is the operator of the motor of the gas chamber, Marchenko Ivan. The two of them have been photographed in the uniform of the guards in the SS forces. That is to say, in the 12th of August 1978, not only the name is mentioned, but the OSI also is within the possession of the picture of the real Ivan the Terrible, a picture which has no similarity whatsoever to Demjanjuk. Demjanjuk is bottom left, and this is the picture, and everyone can see that there is no similarity whatsoever between the two faces. Besides the different name, of course, and many other features. Now, if you would expect the OSI to review his position about the case, which was filed in, as I said, September 1977, and not yet started the actual proceedings in court, if you would expect, as everyone else would expect, that they will review their position due to the new material which they have in their possession, which of course prove beyond any doubt that Demjanjuk cannot be Ivan the Terrible, the OSI didn't do it. They also didn't terminate the case. And they decided to continue with it as nothing happens, as all this material is not in their possession. And they decided to continue with the case to revoke Demjanjuk's American citizenship for being a man which they knew very well at this stage that he isn't. Ivan the Terrible. They knew very well that there is no way whatsoever that Demjanjuk can be Ivan the Terrible. Yet they decided to proceed with the case. But this doesn't end the misconduct. Towards the middle of 1979, the OSI get another additional material from the Soviet Union. This time, we are talking about two statements. One of a Treblinka guard by the name of Nikolai Malagon, and the other, it's a Sobibor guard by the name of Ignat Danilchenko. Now, the first one, Malagon, categorically excluded, pointing at the picture of Demjanjuk, that that person ever put his feet in Treblinka. And specifically, that this is not the face of the person known in Treblinka as Ivan the Terrible, the operator of the gas chambers. And he also specifically named Ivan Marchenko as the one which is the real Ivan the Terrible. The other one, Danilchenko, pointed at the same picture as all the survivors pointed, the picture of Demjanjuk, and said, this person was with me in the death camp of Sobibor, and he said that it was exactly at the very same time that the Jewish survivors that identified this face as Ivan the Terrible said he was with them in Treblinka. In other words, what the OSI has now in his hands, as far as the allegation of Demjanjuk being Ivan the Terrible, a clear-cut alibi. Because the same face is identified to be exactly at the same time in a different place more than 100 miles away. That's the distance between Sobibor and Treblinka. Now, this statement of Danilchenko completed the Soviet plot, which I will not go to details because it's out of the focus of my presentation and testimony. But one thing is clear. First and foremost, the OSI now has in its possession an alibi testimony, which we all know is the most important piece of evidence a defendant can have. I was in other place when the crimes you attributed to me to commit them. What does the OSI do with this material? Nothing. It didn't reveal them, not to Demjanjuk's lawyers, not to the courts which later on tried this case. And only in 1986, this material was turned to the defense through a court order of a federal court in Washington. Meanwhile, Demjanjuk was stripped from his American citizenship, extradited to the State of Israel for being Ivan the Terrible, and this material deliberately concealed from his lawyers and from the courts in this country. Towards the end of 1979, the OSI people going to Germany to interview an SS sergeant from Treblinka named Otto Horn, which was one of the most brutal murderers in Treblinka. They did it, we know from internal memos which were revealed to us later on, years later, that the OSI people attached tremendous importance to the fact that Demjanjuk will be identified as Ivan the Terrible not only by Jewish survivors, but at least by one of the SS murderers of Treblinka. Therefore, they went to Germany to secure the identification of Demjanjuk as Ivan the Terrible by that SS sergeant, Otto Horn, which lived in West Berlin at the time. In 14th of November 1979, Otto Horn was interviewed by the OSI people, and it was a complete failure. The OSI showed him the picture of Demjanjuk, this one. He failed to identify him, not only as Ivan the Terrible, but even as a guard from Treblinka, or even someone he knew from the time he served within the SS forces. The following day, George Garand, one of the three OSI people which took part in this interview, the other two are Norman Moscovich and Bernard Duarte, he wrote a memo describing exactly what I just told you. Now, when this memo arrived to the OSI headquarters in Washington, somebody within the OSI, which we do not know yet till this very day who is he, decided to dump this report, not to reveal it. And we were crossing Otto Horn in a death penalty case without having this document in our possession. which was deliberately dumped by the OSI and not given to the defense lawyers of John Demjanjuk. From the dozens of bureaucrats of the OSI, at this stage, one, George Parker, became alert of what's happening. And he wrote a 5-page memorandum explaining why there is no case whatsoever against Demjanjuk in any allegation or charges whatsoever, the Soviet-initiated ones or those which exploded in Israel due to the mistaken identity proceedings through the suggestive photo spreads. Now, not only he wrote a memorandum and sent it to the head of the OSI at the time, Ellen Ryan, but he asked an interview with Ellen Ryan and tried to persuade him to drop the case, not to proceed with the case. We are talking now at the very end of 1980, October 1980, the proceedings against Demjanjuk in court not yet started, the actual hearings of evidence. He was not listened to. And the proceedings started as nothing happened in February 1981. When George Parker realized that that is what's going to happen, he decided to quit the OSI. He felt that he cannot take part in this frame-up on one hand and cover-up on the other hand. And he quit the OSI. Now, he revealed all those facts in an interview he gave to NBC television in November 1991, 11 years later. And in this interview, he showed that memorandum which he wrote 11 years before, 11 and a half years before. And also, he noted that as early as 1979, internal documents of the OSI related to Ivan Marchenko and Nikolai Shelaev as the two individuals which operated the gas chambers in Treblinka, Ivan Marchenko, known as Ivan the Terrible. He all revealed this in this open interview to the NBC in November 1991. However, my strong position is that George Parker is not better and in some aspects even worse than the bureaucrats of the OSI, because he wanted to wash his hands of physically bringing the execution of Demjanjuk for being what he is not. But he made this thing possible to happen, because in February 1981, when the proceedings took place, he kept his mouth shut. And he knew exactly, and he wrote a whole memorandum telling the reasons why Demjanjuk is not Ivan the Terrible. And his citizenship was revoked just because he is allegedly Ivan the Terrible. And he knew also where the evidence that shows that he's not Ivan the Terrible, where they're lying. Where do they exist? And he kept his mouth shut.
Parker. You're talking about Parker now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, in 1986, 28th of February, Demjanjuk was extradited to the state of Israel because the U.S. court ruled that he's Ivan the Terrible. Parker knew he's not. Parker knew he's facing now a death penalty. He kept his mouth shut. In 25th of April, 1988, Demjanjuk was sentenced to death for one reason only, for being Ivan the Terrible. And again, George Parker keeps his mouth shut. He only opened his mouth in November 1991, when everything was revealed by the defense. When we went in September 1990 to the Soviet Union and got the documents, 80 of them, which proves unequivocally that Ivan Marchenko is Ivan the Terrible. He only opened his mouth when Congressman James Traficant revealed publicly the two telegrams I was referring to before. So actually, when he went to television, he was scared for his own skin. And he wanted to jump on the carriage and to say, look, I have also something to tell about that conspiracy. But where he was for 11 years, knowing exactly that it's a conspiracy, and he wrote about it a whole memorandum of 5 pages. So being so alert and so aware of what's going on and keeping your mouth shut in such dreadful circumstances, to my opinion, doesn't make George Parker the only righteous man in the sodomy of the OSI. No way. The worst atrocity, really, it's difficult. When I will read this document to you in seconds, you will not be able to believe. But the worst comes when Demjanjuk was finally extradited to the State of Israel through proceedings of the OSI in the 28th of February, 1986. Few weeks later, his son-in-law, Ed Nishnik, filed a lawsuit based on FOIA to get the entire file, the entire dossier about Demjanjuk, which is in the possession of the OSI. And we have a memo written to Martin Zaks, which is one of the trial attorneys of the OSI, by no other than Bruce Einhorn, the lead attorney in the proceedings in the Cleveland case. And this is what he writes. This will confirm our discussion regarding your request for information concerning what the effect would be if we were to agree to release to the release of our Demjanjuk files pursuant to several pending FOIA requests. I am familiar with the facts of the Demjanjuk case because I was the lead attorney on it. I am also familiar with the fact that we are currently providing judicial assistance to the State of Israel in their investigation and prosecution of Demjanjuk, who was extradited there this past February. I can state unequivocally that we should oppose release of our files for the following reasons. Concern over the integrity of the Israeli prosecution. Release of our material now would in all probability reveal and could easily undermine and prejudice the Israeli prosecution strategy. What is this strategy? To execute Demjanjuk for being even the terrible, while he knows that he is not. And he doesn't want to undermine that strategy. To hang someone where he knows that he is not that man, that he's going to be hanged for. That's what he's saying, black on white in writing. Conversely, there is the expected publicity that would naturally attach to release of certain and often dramatic material. He knows it's dramatic because it shows that Demjanjuk is not even the terrible. And the drama which will be created because of the release of this material is no good. Therefore, it will not be released. And here we see cold-bloodedly, in a death case, in a death penalty case, the OSI, as an organization, decides not to provide the family of the accused in these proceedings the exculpatory material which it has in its possession, that can easily undermine the strategy of his prosecutors. I don't think ever a cover-up was proven by its perpetrator's material so unequivocal, in writing, black on white, as this cover-up of the OSI to execute Demjanjuk for being what he is not. I don't think ever in such blunt way you can expose and show a cover-up as this document shows us. But it is even worse. The OSI is fully aware, because we are now in 1986, that the defense team has no access whatsoever to the Soviet Union or to Poland, where this material in its possession is originated from. So the OSI is fully aware that if they will not disclose this material to Demjanjuk, he will never, ever, under any circumstances, will be able to get this material. Because no one could foresee in 1986 that 3.5 years, 4 years onwards, the Soviet Union will collapse and the entire communist regimes in Eastern Europe will collapse, as happened, and made it possible to us to get ourselves this material. But nobody could anticipate this in 1986. No one. Now, there was enormous amount of publicity when this cover-up exploded to the air, to the amount that the judges of the Federal Court of Appeal for the Sixth Circuit read about all these revelations in the newspapers. And Judge William Merritt decided from his own initiative to reopen the extradition proceedings of Demjanjuk to the State of Israel. And the court for the Sixth Circuit, the Court of Appeal for the Sixth Circuit, nominated at the 5th of June, 1992, from his own initiative, a special master, Judge Thomas Weissman, to investigate on the Court of Appeal behalf whether the extradition and the denaturalization case of Demjanjuk were product of fraud upon the US courts. And Judge Thomas Weissman held extensive hearings in the second half of 1992 and the first half of 1993, and came out with a devastating report at the 29th of June 1993. And based on this devastating report of Judge Thomas Weissman, at the 17th of November 1993, the Federal Court of Appeal for the Sixth Circuit decided as follows, after totally disbelief to everything the OSI people told him during these proceedings. Now, of course, I will not read to you the entire decision, but small, very important, relevant parts. Page 4. As early as 1978 or 1979, the government had information from official sources within the Soviet Union indicating that there were two Ukrainian operators of the gas chamber at Treblinka, Ivan and Nikolai, and that Ivan Grozny, Ivan the Terrible, was a man named Ivan Marchenko, not Ivan Demjanjuk. Page 11. It seems clear that the American courts, considering Demjanjuk's fate, should have had those documents that were in the OSI possession that pointed to Ivan Marchenko as Ivan the Terrible. And then it goes on. The OSI attorney acted with reckless disregard for their duty to the court and their discovery obligations in failing to disclose at least three sets of documents in their possession before the proceedings against Demjanjuk ever reached trial, because they are in their possession from 78, as we saw, and the trial proceedings started only in 81. And then the court concludes, thus we hold that the OSI attorney acted with reckless disregard for the truth and for the government obligation to take no steps that prevent an adversary from presenting his case fully and fairly. This was fraud on the court in the circumstances of this case. And finally, as a result of all this, for the reasons set out herein, we vacate the judgment of the district court and the judgment of this court in the extradition proceedings on the ground that the judgments were wrongly procured as a result of a prosecutorial misconduct that constituted fraud on the court. Black on white. In the most unequivocal terms possible. Now, in this case, not only we were able to prove the cover-up, the cold-blooded conspiracy, but we also were able to prove the motives and the reasons behind, even this. And in order to get to this, I would like to refer you to the following. At the 25th of August, 1978, Congressman Joshua Eilberg, then chairman of the Subcommittee on Immigration, writes a letter to Mr. Griffin Bell, then the General Attorney of the United States. And here is the letter word by word, since it's a short one, I will read it all. Reports have reached me that deficiencies have become apparent in the preparation of the case of the United States versus Demjanjuk, a denaturalization proceeding against an alleged Nazi war criminal now living in Cleveland, Ohio. I wish to express my strong concern of the possible inadequate prosecution of the case. A repeat of the recent Fedorenko adverse decision to the government's case in Florida would nullify and gravely jeopardize the long and persistent efforts of this subcommittee in ridding this country of the undesirable of these undesirable elements. The creation of the Special Litigation Unit, the OSI, within the INS was established to bring expertise and organization to this process. This unit should be fully entrusted with these cases. I would strongly argue to place the direction of the proceedings of the Demjanjuk case in the hands of the Special Litigation Unit. We cannot afford the risk of losing another decision. This is 25th of August, 1978, 13 days after the OSI, this Special Litigation Unit gets to its hand the material that shows that the Demjanjuk is never can be even the terrible. But because of this letter and other political pressures, which I will refer later, they are afraid to come out and say, we got it all wrong. Demjanjuk is not even the terrible whatsoever. It's someone else. And because of such letter and political pressures that demonstrated by such letter, the OSI people didn't dare to reveal the real facts about this case and decided to dump this exculpatory material and not reveal it, not to the courts and not to the Demjanjuk attorneys, all through the years. But I want to refer you to more than that. The Federal Court of Appeal also addresses this question. And on page 24 of the decision, that's what it says. Mr. Parker wrote in his 1980 memorandum that the denaturalization case could not be dismissed because of factors largely political and obviously considerable. Simple as that. Other lawyers in the OSI wrote memos discussing this case as a political hot potato, that if lost will raise political problems for us all, including the Attorney General. Then the decision continued and saying, Mr. Ryan, director of the office, wrote to the Assistant Attorney General of the Criminal Division in 1980 that the OSI had secured the support in Congress, Jewish community organizations, public at large for the OSI. Press coverage has been substantially favorable and support from Jewish organization is now secure. But he went on to say that this support cannot be taken for granted and must be reinforced at every opportunity. And then it concludes, it is obvious from the record that the Office of Special Investigation must try to please and maintain very close relationship with the various interest groups because their continued existence dependent upon it. So we have the motive and the reasons. Now, indirectly, Alan Ryan himself confirmed it. He gave an interview to an Alabama newspaper called the Huntsville Times in the 30th of October, 1991. And that's what he has to say. It was one of the first cases, he referred to the Demjanjuk case, the first cases we tried. And we were very much on the line. If we had lost that case, we probably would have had very short lifespan. In other words, in order to prolong the lifespan of the OSI, they choose to shorten the lifespan of the Demjanjuk. So, not only we have the conspiracy and the cover-up revealed in the most unequivocal way a cover-up can be revealed, we have even the cynical motive for it, the political pressures behind it.
CPUSA.
We're Communist Party. I'm going to get it. That's the Communist Party of the United States. What this suggests is that the Communist Party has let the FBI know that they want to eliminate Lyndon LaRouche. This is the most incredible piece of FBI material, one of the most incredible pieces of FBI material that I've ever seen, for their political reasons. They consider him to be a politically dangerous person, and the Communist Party wants to eliminate him. If you look at the bottom, New York proposes submitting a blind memorandum to the
Daily World
to foster these efforts. Here's the FBI climbing in bed with the Communist Party in order to effect the elimination of Lyndon LaRouche from the political scene. I think we all know what that means. And they go on to say that it's believed that once eliminated, the political effectiveness of the National Caucus of Labor Committees will thereby be diminished and it will cease to be of any political significance. Here again is the FBI in the 70s in operation. Years went by and $20 million worth of contempt sanctions were imposed. The government then sought to collect that $20 million by filing an involuntary bankruptcy against these organizations in Alexandria, Virginia, just prior to the, not just prior, but some point prior to the Alexandria indictments. They also did this ex parte. They were the only creditor in violation of federal law. But by virtue of their ex parte petition to the judge, we were able to effect the closing of these four businesses, all who engaged in First Amendment advocacy and publication. These businesses were closed. They were seized by federal marshals. They never reopened. The publications never reprinted.
These are book people. They had publishing houses going on, important publications, nonprofit stuff. The government comes in and a completely, these are just some of the peripheral things that Odin and others might not have explained to you. But these are what they were about, ideas, information, social change, meeting the needs of human people all over the world, humanity all over the world. We're going to have a billion more people before the end of this millennium, century, decade, and the vast majority, 80% or more, are going to have beautiful, darker skin, and they're going to live short lives of sickness, hunger, pain, ignorance, and violence unless we act radically. And these books have ideas. Some will work, some won't work, but they're ideas. They can be tested in the marketplace, as we used to say. And they come in with a bankruptcy claim, a false bankruptcy claim against nonprofit publishing houses and shut them down. What's the First Amendment worth, you know? We'll silence you. You'll have no books out there.
when it came to getting me, it was the same apparatus that I find, in my opinion, was used in these other cases. As in the Frühmenschen case, the Weaver case, the Waco case, the case of Waldheim, the case of Demjanjuk, in other cases, always there's that agency inside the Justice Department which works for contract like a hitman when somebody with the right credentials and passwords walks in and says, we want to get this group of people or we want to get this person. And that until we remove from our system of government a rotten, permanent bureaucracy which acts like contract assassins, using the authority of the justice system to perpetrate assassination, this country is not free, nor anyone in it. And it appears to me that this nest around Mark Richard and Jack Keaney and others in the permanent bureaucracy of the Justice Department, if they're not the heart of the problem, they're close enough to it that if you pull out that cancer, you may find out where the next one is.
For years, you know, I have watched that government, Griffin Bale, do even worse things to other American citizens who were not white. This, the fact that the Attorney General of the United States would take the position that you outline here demonstrates a problem far beyond that case or even the cases I'm talking about.
We have, in my view, a system of injustice whose center is within the Department of Justice, especially the criminal division of the U.S. Department of Justice. The problem lies not with one administration or another, though one administration or another may act more positively or more negatively. You have permanent civil service employees like Deputy Assistant Attorneys General Jack Keaney and Mark Richard, who are coordinators of a nest of institutions in the criminal division, which show up repeatedly as leading or key associates of every legal atrocity which I've seen. This is the case with the so-called Frühmenschen operation, which is largely an FBI operation, but cannot run without cooperation from these people and their assistants. The case of the Demjanjuk case, which is outstanding, of a man who they, according to the Sixth Circuit, a man who the Justice Department knew to be innocent of the charges they were making against him at the time they made the charges. And yet, Mark Richard and Jack Keaney and so forth proceeded with that case, an attempt to secure the execution of this man in Israel over the objections of the Israeli government for an OSI operation which was set into place by Henry Kissinger some years before.
But the OSI ought to be abolished. It should never have been created. It's an instrument of hatred when there ought to be an end to it. It's not, however, the office that caused Waco or so many other things. We have a new and dangerous mentality.
We are coming in very hard and vicious times in which it is very embarrassing to speak of Nazi Germany for comparisons. There are too many cases in our own country which are moving in that direction in terms of our public morality.
Why the United States government would like to fall in the trap of the Soviet Union in a plot like this?
Well, actually, they didn't follow. What happened is that they got from the Soviet Union information that Demjanjuk is allegedly a death camp guard from Sobibor. But then they send his picture to the State of Israel, and then he was identified as Ivan the Terrible from Treblinka. So the case of Demjanjuk all those years was not according the Soviet plan. And the Soviets, I must say, this is Very good that it was brought up. I mean, we can see that in this case, in the case of Demjanjuk, the KGB people were much fairer than the Justice Department. Really, because, and I'll tell you why. The KGB knew all along that Demjanjuk cannot be Ivan the Terrible because they had the full file about the real Ivan the Terrible, and they were scared that one day this file will be revealed, especially when part of it they already revealed to the OSI. So they didn't dare, even for once, for the last 16, 17 years, to suggest that Demjanjuk is Ivan the Terrible. When the OSI got a material which shows unequivocally that same Soviet material, that Demjanjuk is not Ivan the Terrible, they didn't stop telling that he is Ivan the Terrible. They dared to do what the Soviet didn't. They continued to pursue the case of Ivan the Terrible having in their possession all the material which shows that he is not, a thing which deterred all those years the KGB from pursuing this line, even after he was identified by about a dozen Jewish survivors in the state of Israel as Ivan the Terrible. They still never, ever, even for once, suggested that he's Ivan the Terrible. Therefore, at this particular case, the Justice Department is much worse of a villain than the KGB.